Hello friends, first of all a very warm welcome to all of you on our channel, that is GYAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently we have 10 series that target your prelims and one series that is mains oriented. So what are our prelim series? These are basically series in which we daily cover MCQs. So at least we pick two topics daily, and we cover 10 MCQs of each topic. So in this way 20 MCQs are covered daily, and we will continue to do so till 31st May. So friends, why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC CSE 2019, and we will end this series only one day before your prelims exam. So the first question, today's video is about the geography topic, and we are covering lecture number 8 of this geography. Already we have covered 7 lectures, so let's see what are the questions of today. So first question is, in one of the northeastern states of India, an ingenious system of tapping of stream and spring water by using bamboo pipes to irrigate plantations is widely prevalent. This state is, so friends, there is a particular state in northeastern India that uses the bamboo that uses bamboo pipes. So bamboo is a type of tree, so its pipes are used to irrigate their plantations. So we are asked that which state is it's that? A. Arunachal Pradesh, B. Meghalaya, C. Manipur, D. Assam. So let me tell you friends that the correct answer is Meghalaya. It is the Meghalaya which uses this technology. So it is basically 200 year old system in which is prevalent in basically the in Jayantia Hills, then in Khasi Hills, and the region has very steep slopes and rocky terrain, so the groundwater channels cannot be utilized for irrigation purposes. For this they have devised an ingenious method of irrigating their plantations, and this is traditional technology, and it uses available material, locally available material, while harnessing the forces of gravity. So also friends, land used for cultivation is owned by the clan of the tribe, and it is allocated by paying the one-time rent, so to different individuals of the clan. So it is basically to the responsibility of a clan elders to distribute the land to different individuals for sowing. So this is about your first question. So here I have included a diagram, so you can see here there is a bamboo, these are the bamboo pipes through which the water is channelized to the plantations, and thus in this way the irrigation takes place. So this, you can see that this, in this way the traditional technology is used for irrigating. So it also kind of highlights that how local communities can better utilize water and other things that are available locally than others that are not local to that region. So for that reason, in policy circles there is a continuous debate that locals should be included in the conservation of particular lands, because they have the better idea of the ecology of that region. So let's move on to the second question. The second question is about which of the following locations is nearest to the equator. So this is a map based question friends. You have to tell that which of the following is the is nearest to the equator. So A is Malé, B is Jakarta, C Bandung, D Yogyakarta. Let me tell you friends that the nearest location to the equator is Malé. So basically Malé is the part of Maldives. It is an island which is nearest to equator. So Malé has the following latitudes. So Jakarta is little bit farther from equator. So here I have included the map. So here I also have kind of highlighted those regions. So let me again highlight, so you can see here the Malé. So this is Malé, which is nearest to equator. So here is equator, the line is passing through this is line of equator, and basically you can see that here the Jakarta is quite far from equator. So after that comes Bandung, and then comes Yogyakarta. So this is the correct sequence. So you must be knowing about all these facts. So this is a Central Asian, South Asian map. So you can see here the Maldives country, the Sri Lanka, and then you can see here the equator, and there you can see the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So this is Andaman Sea, which is in east of Andaman Nicobar Islands, and this is the Andaman Nicobar Island is the territory of India, and then here begins the your Sumatra Island. So this is your Sumatra Island, and this is part of Malay Peninsula. So Malaysia, it is part of Malaysia. This territory is part of Malaysia, and it is is here, their capital is Kuala Lumpur, and basically this is a strait. This is called the Strait of Malacca, from which a great degree of trade and other ships pass through, and it is a strategic choke point. So China is concerned about this strategic choke point because the majority of its energy needs are met through this strait. So next question is also on Strait of Malacca. Strait of Malacca is a waterway. So as I have already told you, so you have to tell first connecting the Andaman Sea in the Indian Ocean and the South China Sea. Second, running between the Malay Peninsula and Sumatra Island in Indonesia. So you would be able to obviously see here that this is Malay Peninsula and here is Sumatra. So obviously it passes through this. So yes, second statement is true. Regarding first statement, friends, yes, first statement is also true because here is Andaman Sea. You can see here I have highlighted it, and here is if you move here, you then here here the area is not shown, but that is South China Sea. So it connects the Andaman Sea in the Indian Ocean and the South China Sea. So the both are correct. Both the statements are correct. So the answer is C. So justification is basically it is a narrow 850 kilometer stretch of water that is between Malay Peninsula and Indonesian island of Sumatra. So it is a strategic choke point for shipping supplies from East Asia heading to the South Asia. So it is a main shipping channel, and it links Indian Ocean and Pacific Ocean, and also it links major Asian economies like Japan with the like Japan and China with Korea and India and Sri Lanka and all those things. So about a quarter of all oil that is carried by sea passes through it passes through the Strait of Malacca. So it is mainly from the supplies come mainly from Persian Gulf, and it is supplied to the Asian markets, for example China. So this is about your third question. Let's move on to the fourth question. Fourth question is also map based question. Fourth question is, if you draw a line between Vladivostok and Macau on a map, which of these will lie on the right hand side of the line? One, Spratly Islands. Second, Paracel Islands. Third, Philippine Sea. So let me tell you, friends, that all of these will lie on the right hand side of this line, which is to be drawn between Vladivostok and Macau. So let me tell you that Vladivostok is one of the easternmost points of Russia, and Macau is part of China, and it is a coastal city on the eastern part of the China. So all these will lie to the right hand side of this line. So here I have included a picture where you can get better idea. I have included an image, so you can see here this is Vladivostok, this is part of Russia, and this is Macau, which is part of China. So it is near Hong Kong, so you can see it. So if you draw a line between it, so let me tell you, friends, that the map is based on projections. So ultimately you will see here that if you draw a line, then it will come here, it will a middle line will be here. So you will say that, sir, that Paracel Islands and out these Spratly Islands, they lie on the left hand side of this line. So how can we say that this is they are on the right side? But let me tell you, friends, this projection is not right. Actually, if we properly project I don't know what to say this projection, because it is better known to the geography teachers that what is this, for the what are these projections, different type of projections in maps. But let me tell you that if projection is right, then these all will lie to the right of this middle line that will pass through the Vladivostok and Macau, the middle line between Vladivostok and Macau. So you have to keep these in mind. So this is Philippine Sea, that is east of the Philippine country. So here is you can see that Taiwan and Taipei, its capital, and here is Hong Kong. So please have a look at this map. So here in you can see the North Korea, and you can see the South Korea. Seoul is the capital of South Korea, and Pyongyang is the capital of North Korea. So this is Vladivostok, which is part of Russia, and here is Japan, and this is the part of there are different islands. So Kaidu Island, and this is Tokyo and Shikoku and Kyushu. So these are the Yellow Sea, which is kind of surrounded by the China and South Korea. So please have a look at them, and this is East China Sea. So please keep this in mind. This is East China Sea, and the South China Sea is here. This is South China Sea. So basically, it is the South China Sea is considerably disputable territory, and because China is expanding its activity in this sea. So let's move on to the fifth question. The fifth question is, in which of the following states of India the net zone area as a percentage of total area is highest? So here we have been asked that in which of the following state the net zone area of the total area is highest. So A is Arunachal Pradesh, B is Mizoram, C is Punjab, D is Manipur. Let me tell you, friends, that it is a very simple question. You would be easily able to take it, because Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, and Manipur all are hilly states, so they have a rocky terrain, so they are not much suitable for agriculture. So plain areas are better suitable for agriculture, and Punjab is a plain area, so it is basically watered by Satluj River, by Bias River, so that are part of the Indus River system. So it is a plain area, and let me tell you that Punjab and Haryana have approximately 80% of their total area as net zone area. So they have the highest net zone area in these given options. So Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, and Manipur, and all these Andaman Islands, they have very very less amount of net zone area. So it is a very easy question which you will be easily able to judge. So let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is, arrange the following physical features of Asia from north to south. So friends, here we have been given certain features of Asia, physical features, and we have to arrange them from north to south. First is Kunlun Shan Mountains, second is Gobi Desert, third is Arakan Mountain. So let me tell you friends that the Arakan Mountains are in Malaysia, are in Myanmar. So they are basically between the Rakhine Strait and the central Burma basin, which is basically basin of Irrawaddy River. So Arakan Mountains are in Myanmar. So Myanmar is south of both Gobi Desert and Kunlun Shan Mountains. And let me tell you that Kunlun Shan Mountains are in China and Gobi Desert is in Mongolia. So obviously Mongolia is in the north of the China. So at the northernmost point will come the Gobi Desert, and then will come the Kunlun Shan Mountains, and then will come the Arakan Mountains. So the correct order will be 2, 1, 3. So the answer will be D. That is first Gobi Desert, and next Kunlun Shan Mountains, and then Arakan Mountains. So let me show you in the map. So here is the physical features. You can see here China. So here are the Himalayas, and to the south of it is the Nepal and India. So you can see here the Kashmir, the Srinagar, and this Islamabad, Pakistan, and here the Afghanistan. So here is the China, and this is the Tibet part of China, and to the north of Tibet is the Kunlun Shan Mountain. So you can say that the Tibet is between the Kunlun Shan Mountains and the Himalayan range. So there are other mountains also. Here is the Gobi Desert, which is in Mongolia. So you can clearly see it that Gobi Desert is in Mongolia. So you have to keep these things in mind. So please do practice of map in a much comprehensive manner so that you can tackle the questions. So let's move on to the seventh question. Seventh question is, consider the following about the Apatani tribes. So there is a tribe called Apatani. So we have Apatani. So we have to consider statements about it. First is, they are one of the major ethnic groups of Eastern Himalayas. The tribe is known for the vibrant traditional village councils called Bulyan. Third is, UNESCO recognizes the wet fish rice cultivation technique of Apatani tribes as highly efficient. So we have to choose the correct statement. So let me tell you friends that all these statements are correct. They are one of the major ethnic groups of Eastern Himalayas, and they have a unique civilizational existence, and that existence has come in kind of harmony with the nature. So they have a considerable knowledge about the local ecology and environment. So they are a kind of example of how the civilization can better harness the potential of the nature and can remain in harmony with it without exploiting it too much to the level that the ecology gets adversely affected. So they are an example to be cited if we have to say that local communities are more vibrant in protecting their ecology. So they have considerable knowledge. So these things substantiate are kind of evidence towards the local involvement in the conservation. So that's why in policy circles it is continuously mentioned that locals must be incorporated, because they have the age old bonding with that area, and they know how to administer it properly and how to manage it and how to conserve it. So justification is here, it lives in the Zero Valley basically of Arunachal Pradesh, and UNESCO notes that it is a major ethnic group, and also it has distinct civilizational and systematic land use practices with traditional knowledge, ecological knowledge of natural resources management and conservation, and this experience has been acquired through continuous experimentation. So they have a colorful culture, and they have different skills in cane and bamboo and bamboo crafts, and they have vibrant traditional village councils called Bulyan, and also this community has evolved a unique skill of fish cultivation, where along with paddy, fish is also reared on the field. So when they cultivate paddy, the fish is also reared on those fields. So they are a kind of tribe that have unique civilizational, we can say, structure. So let's move on to the eighth question. Eighth question is, if you happen to take the shortest and aerial route between Uttarakhand and Odisha, which of the following major dams will lie eastwards from your route? So you are asked to take a aerial route from Uttarakhand to Odisha, and you have to tell that which of the following will the dams will come in your journey, basically from which will lie in the eastward towards your journey. So first is Panchet, second is Mathur, third is Rana Pratap Sagar. So let me tell you friends that the second statement cannot be the answer because it is in South India. So obviously it cannot figure in your aerial route. So obviously this statement is wrong. Regarding third statement, Rana Pratap Sagar, let me tell you that this dam is on Chambal River. So some Chambal River is in Rajasthan. So obviously Rajasthan is towards the westward side of the Uttarakhand, and also it will not also cover in your will appear in your journey. So obviously this Panchet dam will appear because this is a dam on the Damodar River. So this is a dam basically the Damodar River, and it will come in your journey. So only first is the correct answer. So the option will be B. So here you can see that this Panchet dam is constructed on river Panchet on the Damodar River at Panchet in Dhanbad district in Jharkhand. So Mathur dam is in South India, and Rana Pratap Sagar dam is on the Chambal River. So let's move on to the ninth question. The ninth question is, which of the major iron ore belts in India are? First Odisha Jharkhand belt, second Durg Bastar Chandrapur belt, third Bellary Chitradurga Chikamgalur Tumkur belt. So we have been asked that which of the following are the iron ore belts. So let me tell you friends that all of these are the iron ore belts. If you see the Odisha and Jharkhand belt, then Bastar region, and this we can say in Odisha also, there is good quality of high hematite ore that is available. So this is correct. First is correct, and regarding the second is also correct. Durg is a district in Chhattisgarh, and also Chandrapur is a district in Maharashtra. So this is basically Maharashtra and Chhattisgarh belt. So Bastar is also in Chhattisgarh. So there considerable mining takes place of iron ore, and also this third is also correct because this Chitradurga, Chikmagalur, Tumkur and Bellary belt, this is basically in Karnataka. So also friends, there is a belt of iron ore in Goa and Maharashtra. So that belt is totally dedicated to export of the iron ore. So the answer will be D. So here there is the explanation. So basically in Odisha, high grade hematite ore is found in Badampur mine, Badam Pahar mines in Mayurbhunj and Kendujhar districts. So these are the important districts, so please keep them in mind. Badam Pahar mines, keep them in mind also. And also in the adjoining Singbhum district of Jharkhand, hematite iron ore is mined in Gua and Noamundi. So regarding second statement is also correct because this belt your Chandrapur and Durg belt and your Bastar belt, this lies in Chhattisgarh and Maharashtra, and very high grade hematites are found in the famous Beladila range of hills in Bastar district of Chhattisgarh. And statement 3 is also correct because this belt is in Karnataka, and there is also one more belt of iron ore found in India, and that is Maharashtra Goa belt, which includes the Goa state as well and the Ratnagiri district of Maharashtra. So the iron is though not of very high quality, but yet it is exploited to a considerable extent, and it is exploited efficiently, and it is totally dedicated to the export. It has totally dedicated export unit, that is called Mukh mines. They are 100% export unit. So there was also a question that I have asked in the environment part yesterday, that Kudermukh yesterday or day before yesterday, there was a question on Kudermukh block. So it is the largest block that is a kind of Western Ghats that is protected. So it is a UNESCO kind of World Heritage Site. It is recognized by UNESCO also. So let's move on to the 10th question. The 10th question and the last question, this is about the cropping seasons. So here are the cropping seasons, that is Rabi, Kharif and Zayad, and we have to consider the statements about them. First is Zayad crops are sown at the start of winter and harvested in summer. Second, Kharif crops are grown with the onset of monsoon. Third, gram and mustard are important Rabi crops. And fourth is Rabi crops cannot be grown without irrigation facilities. So we have to tell that which of the following statements statements are correct. Let me tell you, friends, that the first statement is clearly wrong because zaid crops are not sown at the start of the winter. Actually, they are sown at the end of the winter season. And when the monsoon season begins, they are sown before the monsoon season, and in the months of April approximately. So the zaid crops are basically the vegetable crops or the crops that are used in salad. So the kind of horticulture crops are dominant during the zaid season. And once first statement is clearly wrong, thus kharif crops are grown with the onset of monsoon. Yes, this is correct, because there are kharif crops that are grown with the onset of monsoon. When the monsoon comes in India and kharif crops are sown, and there are many kharif crops like cotton, jute, and then we have jowar, bajra, and we have also maize cultivation also. So these are important kharif crops. And gram and mustard are important rabi crops. Yes, friend, this is correct. Rabi crop also includes your wheat also. So this wheat is also sown during the rabi crops. Regarding the fourth statement, friends, let me tell you that fourth statement is incorrect. Yes, rabi crops can be grown without irrigation facilities, but yes, there is one problem, because the irrigation facilities actually increase their productivity. The productivity increases with the availability of irrigation facilities, but it is not a necessary condition, because rabi crops are mainly planted in northwestern parts of India, for example the states of Punjab, Haryana, and Jammu Kashmir and Uttarakhand, and these states receive rainfall during the winter season through the western disturbances that come from Mediterranean Sea. So nowadays, if you might have heard in the news that rainfall is taking place, or snowfall is taking place in hilly areas, or rainfall is taking place in plain areas of India, that is northwestern parts of India. So they are basically receiving these western disturbances that come from Mediterranean Sea, and they are responsible for this rain. So they are also responsible for the kind of snowfall, and also for the continuous flow of the Gangetic rivers and Indo-Gangetic rivers, because ultimately they flow by the melting of glaciers, which can kind of rejuvenate after the snowfall. So they get the water, or they get the snow from this western disturbances snow, so which ultimately gets melted in summer season, and it flows in the form of water in major rivers of India, for example Ganga, Yamuna, and this year in the Indus river system. So this is about your today's topic. So solution is C, as I have told you that only second and third statement is correct. So here is in detail explanation, you can see about this. And friends, this is all about today's video, and if you like the questions, please like it, share it with your friends, and please, if you have any suggestion, then do tell me in the comment box. I will certainly consider your suggestions. And friends, let me tell you that if you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, then you can do WhatsApp us at this number, that is 8968426481. I have highlighted this number, and I repeat, 8968426481. So you can contact us at this number. This number will be if you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs. So obviously we will be charging certain amount for these PDFs, because we are putting in a lot of effort. So obviously these efforts must have some fruits for us also, because if we don't charge you people, then ultimately it is difficult to maintain that motivation and that consistency that is needed for the continuous upload of videos. And let me tell you, friends, that we are very practical persons and ideal persons who live in ideal world. And please refrain from messaging us and those kind of things that they say that you should do welfare and all these things. Please, it is my humble request, please stay away from this channel. This channel is based on the team that is totally practical. After all, we also have to sustain ourselves. If you are preparing for UPSC, then you have also the vested interests. If you tomorrow become IAS, you will certainly not renounce your salary or perks. In fact, you are preparing for the salary and the perks and the social status it offers. If you are ready to renounce your perks, if you are ready to go by bicycle, then we will also renounce our claims on our efforts. So please refrain from messaging if you are ideal person, but if you are practical and if you want to subscribe to these PDFs, then you can do WhatsApp us at this number. Because why these PDFs are important? Because at the end of the day, it is not possible to see 25 to 30 minute long video, because it would be an utter wastage of time, and also at that time you will have to revise multiple topics and multiple subjects, and at that time you can't read standard books or NCERTs because you must revise quickly so that that revision takes place 3-4 times and without any wastage of time. So that cannot happen by following standard books. So because standard books become monotonous and boring after second or third reading. So you must revise, and this revision is most effective in this MCQ format because these MCQs are designed in a manner that they cover most important aspects of your syllabus, and they also helps you in revision because these are the questions in which explanation is also given and the solution, and not only the solution is given and also explanation is given. It is also told that why a particular option is correct and why a particular option is not correct. So for that reason, these are PDFs are important because they will help you to revise quickly. So if you want to subscribe to them, you can do WhatsApp us at this number, that is 8968426481. So lastly, friends, if you like this video, please like it, share it with your friends, and please subscribe to our channel, and do not forget to press the bell icon because then only you will get all the important notifications relating to UPSC CSE 2019 that we will do on our channel, that is Achieve IAS, that is channel based on YouTube. So this is all about today's video. Have a nice day. Thank you very much.